so everybody get your favorite recipes out and bring them on in. We're going to talk about some of the issues of our church and do some planning together. We're going to talk about finances. There'll be reports from the General Synod and just some things that we all need to talk about and plan together instead of just our committees. We need to do it together. So come out next Sunday, bring your food. If you're watching us on Facebook, go ahead and come. We'd love to have you. You're still a part of us, so come and join us with our meal and our discussion. Next week is our rummage sale, just set up September the 5th through the 7th, and the sale will be the 8th and 9th. And I'm sure we need some help still for people to sign up or just come and help as the world's trying to pull this together. And then our women's fellowship will be starting back this month on the 13th, and we're going to meet at 1 o'clock. If you have any questions, you can talk to Deanna. Okay. And I think that we have another announcement.
I make an announcement about the Red Cross. Our November Red Cross blood drive here is canceled. They called me this week and found out that they had two scheduled to be clients that day. So I think they're going to keep the Eagles. They asked if we could postpone ours or get a new date. So our blood drive now will be on Wednesday, December 6th. Wednesday, December 6th, 1 to 6:30. I hope we have a blood drive like we did in August. We had 32 donations. They were overjoyed. And not one donation came from this church, including myself. I was over the limit because I give platelets so much. But I hope we have at least one on December 6th. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now for our message preview. I think I know the answer to this question, but how many of you watch some of the women's World Cup soccer? Oh, a couple of hands, that's good, not bad. I missed most of the games, but I did get up at 6:30 a.m. for the final between Spain and England, and it was an incredible match. I was actually still sleeping, and Laura said, Jim, you gotta get up, this is so good. So I got up. And both teams played so well. Spain really seemed to dominate the game for most of the time, so I'm really glad they won. Because I've seen soccer games in which one team dominates most of the game, but never scores, and then the other team gets a lucky break and scores, and the dominant team loses. But that was not the case this time. Anyway, there were a lot of tears flowing after the game, both by the players from Spain and the players from England. And it's common after a soccer game that the players line up at center field after the game and all shake hands after a match. And the teams our daughter Ariel played on, both her travel team and her high school team, always lined up to shake hands with the opposing team, no matter who won or lost. Now, one thing I noticed that there were a few Spanish players who, like the show in the photo there, put their arm around some of the English players after the match, who seemed especially distraught at losing. And although the women from Spain won, they didn't rub it in the faces of the women from England. They showed compassion and mercy, even when they felt like dancing in victory. And what a lesson for us. Let's pray. Holy and living God, we are so, so grateful for your love of us, regardless of what we do or what we say. Help us, God, to live that love in all that we do. In those times when we wish to rejoice, help us to rejoice in thanksgiving to you, and then understand in our hearts that perhaps some are not feeling the same way, that we may show mercy and compassion to them and show your love to them through us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. the time that our worship service would be lifting special joys and concerns in our own lives or lives of those we love or care for, and even just things going on in the world that we feel compelled to lift in prayer. I'll try to summarize each of those prayers and say, Lord, in your mercy, we ask that you respond. Hear our prayers. Are there any special joys or concerns we can lift on this morning? Joe, we'd just like to express her love for and thanks for all the love and care that she's received from all of you in the cards and the support, especially from her children. Lord, in your mercy.
I've been asking prayer for my brother Bob Stearns for this wound on his foot. He's been having trouble with it. The doctor decided to take his big toe off. So Thursday he had this surgery, and so I just pray for recovery from this and that infection will go away.
So prayers for Becky's brother Bob Stern, who had to have a toe amputated because of the infection. So prayers for healing for Bob. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
I'd also like to lift up the Stork family again for the celebration of life last Friday of their brother Paul Stork, who died unexpectedly the week before. Lord, in your mercy. And for prayers for Fred Gruber, who's continuing to have health issues, and for Nancy in support of him, Lord, in your mercy. And for Marge DeStanley, who was briefly hospitalized but is expecting to come out today, Lord, in your mercy. And again, continued prayers for Sally Myers, in her recovery and support during this time when she's undergoing chemo. Lord, in your mercy.
Well, I just want to thank everybody because the last 2 years my brother has been so ill and just a lot of problems. And 3 weeks ago today he was in my hospital and we didn't think he was going to come out any now. We didn't think he was going to make it. He went to rehab, which today he's going to the County Fair. So he's doing very well this time, thank you.
So prayers, continue prayers and thanks for prayers for Sarah's brother, who just a short while ago we didn't think he was going to make it, and we've been praying for him for a while. And he's actually going to the Fulton County Fair, so he has made a good recovery so far. Lord, in your mercy. So let us spend a few moments gathering these prayers that we heard, along with the prayers that we still hold within the depths of our hearts, and lift them up to God in a few moments of silence. Based on prejudice and fear. goes beyond anything we can explain or understand. Loving God, you invite us to bring all our concerns to you in prayer. And so we do. But not in panic or desperation, not expecting seas to be parted and enemies destroyed, but with quiet confidence that there is nothing that you and we together cannot face, nothing that your love cannot overcome. We pray for the church in these difficult and challenging times. May it all be more difficult and challenging, because we have forgotten who we are and what you have called us to be. Not pillars of society, but pilgrims and refugees. Not thriving entrepreneurs, but faithful servants, following the way of Christ, the servant king. Help us to stand firm in prayer, but also to be flexible and willing to change. Where there are disagreements among us, may we handle them with honesty and respect. Calm the fear in us that leads to anger and division. When dark thoughts intrude, lift our minds to think on all the positives, all the reasons we have to be grateful, and most of all, for your never-failing love brought near to us in the life of Jesus Christ. Hear all these prayers as we pray in the way that he taught, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, for the first time since I've been pastor here, St. John United Church of Christ will be participating in the Defiance College All-Campus Fair this coming Wednesday. And this is an opportunity for students to learn about various student groups on campus and the academic programs that Defiance College offers. And now to learn about St. John United Church of Christ and the Greater United Church of Christ. And it's really your support that makes this opportunity for greater outreach within our community and within the campus possible. So now we invite you to prepare an envelope to leave in the collection plates at all the entrances to the sanctuary if you happen to be here, or if you're participating from home to drop a letter or a check into the mail, or you can always connect with our online giving platform through the URL on the screen or using the QR code that's shown there. God is unfailing in blessings and in love. So with thankful hearts, let us offer up to God a portion of what God has given. Thank you.
Your strong hand, Lord, is dominant in power. Your strong hand, Lord, shatters the enemy. With your great surge, you overthrow your opponents. You send out your hot anger, and it burns up like straw. With the breath of your nostrils, the waters swelled up. The flood surged up in a great wave, and the deep waters foamed in the depths of the sea. The enemy said, I'll pursue, I'll overtake, I'll divide the spoils of war, and I'll be overfilled with them. I'll draw my sword, and my hand will destroy them. You blew with your wind, the sea covered over them. They sank like lead in the towering waters. Who is like you among the gods, Lord? Who is like you, foremost in holiness, worthy of highest praise, doing awesome deeds? Then the prophet Miriam, Aaron's sister, took a tambourine in her hand, and all the women followed her, playing tambourines and dancing. And Miriam sang back to them, singing to the Lord for an overflowing victory. Horse and rider he threw into the sea. Then we flip over to Philippians chapter 4, verses 1 to 9. This is one of my favorite books of the Bible. It talks about joy. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and miss, who are my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord. Loved ones, I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to come to an agreement in the Lord. Yes, and I'm also asking you, loyal friend, to help these women who have struggled together with me in the ministry of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers whose names are in the scroll of life. Rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice. And again I say rejoice. Rejoice.
Players resigned from the team with complaints about the team's manager, also a man who, by the way, after qualifying for the finals four previous times. However, photos also emerge of some of the members of the Spanish team, and so on some of the members from England whom they have defeated. And while the players from Spain may have been dancing for joy at their win, they also acknowledged the pain of defeat for the opposing team. They showed compassion and mercy even in their victory. Well, a few weeks ago, we heard the story of the birth of Moses from the book of Genesis and the role that several different women played in his survival, including unidentified, unnamed woman, who was identified only as Moses' sister. And according to some strands of Jewish tradition, the subject of our reading today from Exodus, Miriam, was the brave, resourceful young woman who assured her baby brother was found by the Pharaoh's daughter and nursed by his own mother. She's the first woman to be named as a prophet. And the refrain attributed to her in Exodus chapter 15, verse 21, together with the whole entire song, verses 1 through 11, which it accompanies, is thought to be one of the oldest pieces of text in the whole of Scripture. In fact, some scholars believe that the Song of Moses, as verses 1 through 11 are referred to, or 1 through 18 actually, are referred to, were originally attributed to Miriam. But patriarchy has its way. And one of the most important things here is that Miriam is not only named, but she's also called a prophet. Women in the Bible are not often identified, or if they are, they're relegated to a brief passage before they disappear altogether. But Miriam foreshadowed her role as a leader among the people when she took the initiative in ensuring Moses' survival. I mean, even the prophet Micah affirmed Miriam's importance and contribution during the Exodus event in verse 4 of the 6th chapter when he writes, "I brought you up out of the land of Egypt, redeemed you from the house of slavery. I sent Moses, Aaron, and Miriam before you." Miriam stood on equal ground with her brothers, Moses and Aaron. Now, the U.S. women's national soccer team is eclipsing the U.S. men's national team as a spectator sport and actually brought in more revenue than the women between 2016 and 2019, despite ticket prices for the women being nearly half that of the men's teams. And after winning a lawsuit recently for equal pay, the women are finally being comparably compensated. But that's not the case the world over. Soccer in Western Europe is primarily, or football as they call it, is primarily a male-dominated sport, both in terms of attendance and in participation, as it is in many other parts of the world. For example, the Jamaican National Women's Soccer Team actually had to open a GoFundMe page to raise enough money to buy airline tickets, pay for accommodations and food after they qualified for the World Cup Finals. On the other hand, the situation is changing in other areas, as witnessed by the Australian women's national team, who drew over 80,000 spectators in the stadium for their World Cup semifinal game against England. After all, having only a few hundred ever attend any of their games just a mere 8 years ago, there is a lot to dance in victory over, but there's still a long way to go in the journey. Now, our story from Exodus places us with Miriam and Moses right after they escaped from the Egyptians who had pursued them through the Red Sea. And the story goes that Moses parted the water, of course with God's help, so that the Israelites could walk across, saving the time and danger that would have been needed to go around the Red Sea. And as soon as the Israelites made it safely to shore, the pursuing Egyptian soldiers were swallowed up by the sea as the water returned over top of them. The Israelites were saved, but the Egyptians were decimated. Well, Laurel and I recently went to the theater to watch the movie Oppenheimer. voice of conscience about the scientific work he had done to develop the atomic bomb. A devastating weapon that not only changed the course of history, but changed all of humanity. And there was a scene in the movie in which Oppenheimer reported on the detonation of the first atomic bomb over the city of Hiroshima. And the director of the film interspersed images of the firestorm and desolation with the jubilation of Oppenheimer and the other workers at Los Alamos, one of the secret sites where much of the testing and the development took place. And Oppenheimer is depicted as really vacillating between elation at the apparent success of his work and dread at what he hoped to unleash upon the world. August 6th and August 9th were the 78th anniversaries of the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, respectively. And it's estimated that as many as 310,000 people died within 4 months of those bombings, many immediately from the blast, and many others from burns and radiation sickness, which they had no idea what that was. While some of the U.S. danced in victory after the capitulation of Japan in the aftermath of the bombings, the suffering in Japan continued. And after hearing reports of the devastating effects of the bombs on the civilian population, especially upon the children, President Truman rescinded his standing order that additional Japanese cities were to be attacked with atomic bombs as they were made ready. And then Japan unconditionally surrendered, I think it was on August 15th. Well, my mind went to that terrible destruction of nuclear weapons as I read the following from Exodus. With your great surge, you overthrow your opponents. You send out your hot anger. It burns them up like straw. With the breath of your nostrils, the water swelled up. The flood surged in a great wave. The deep waters foamed in the depths of the sea. Well, there's a really fine line between the celebration of victory and what in the German language is called Schadenfreude, which basically means joy at the misfortune of someone else. In fact, Proverbs chapter 24, verses 17 through 18 warns against gloating over the defeat of an enemy. When your enemies fall, don't rejoice. When they stumble, don't let your heart be glad, or the Lord will see it and be displeased, and he will turn his anger from them. And yet, as my School of Beings resource points out, it is arguably completely unrealistic to expect anything other than unbridled joy on the part of the people who, according to the story, had been enslaved for longer than any of them could remember, had been treated with increasing brutality, who had no hope, without divine intervention, of escaping their powerful captors when freedom was finally there. Imagine, if you will, how a citizen of Ukraine might feel if an invading Russian army were suddenly wiped out. I can imagine there would be much dancing in the streets. Perhaps, though, not so much over the death of so many Russians as for the end of a war that is causing so much death and destruction in Ukraine and against the Ukrainian people. And Archbishop Robert Bunsen mentioned that in 1982 while he was preaching at the official service of Thanksgiving for the end of the Falklands War between Britain and Argentina. Archbishop Robert Bunsen spoke of the war as a sign of human failure. The following Matthew's version of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is heard providing several injunctions about the law, each of which begins with the phrase, "You have heard it said," and then it's followed by, "But I say to you." And that chapter closes with what the common English Bible headlines as the law of love. Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said, you must love your enemy, or you must love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who harass you, so that you will be acting as children of your Father who is in heaven. Therefore, just as your heavenly Father is complete in showing love to everyone, so also you must be complete. And I heard echoes of that in our reading from Philippians. Let your gentleness show in your treatment of all people. Then the peace of God that exceeds all understanding will keep your hearts and minds safe in Christ Jesus. Dance with joy at victory, giving thanks to God, but not at the demise and misery of your enemy. And so as Paul closed his letter to the Philippians, so I close this message. From now on, brothers and sisters, if anything is excellent, if anything is admirable, focus your thoughts on these things. All that is true, all that is holy, all that is just, all that is pure, all that is lovely, and all that is worthy of praise. Practice these things. Whatever you learned, received, heard, or saw in us, the God of peace will be with you. Something worth dancing about. Amen. And now I invite you to join together with me praying the prayer on the screen. Magnificent God, we bring you our praise and our thanksgiving, as we always do and as we always deserve. But being thankful comes more easily to us than sometimes than others. Our faith comes with questions, big questions, about where you are and who I am, if you exist, the world as it is, but somewhere deep down, we know that you are and that you care. Love, your love, is the air that we breathe. It is the soil in which we grow. And in that is a song with singing. Amen. We celebrate an open table here at St. John United Church. God is here. Jesus is here. The Holy Spirit is here. Now the bread is made ready, the cups are filled, the people, you all are here. The time is now to celebrate the feast of God. So come and share this together. The gifts of God for the people of God. Come. If you are hungry and thirsty, God will meet your need. Come, if you feel full. God bless you. Come, whatever your experience of God, and experience more. Come, whether you are full of faith and searching. Put it all into action right here at this table. All are invited. All are welcome. So listen as we recall the story of why we come to celebrate the Lord's Supper. Jesus ate and drank with his followers in an upper room a long, long time ago. And at the end of the meal, he took some bread that was still on the table and, giving thanks to God, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body given for you. Eat this and remember me." Then Jesus took a cup of wine and he declared, "This is my blood which I shed for you. Drink this to remember me." So let us take our bread and our fruit of the vine, and as we eat the bread and drink the fruit, remember. Remember all that Christ has done for you. Remember Christ, all that Friday night in the church or